Hey guys, in this video I'd like to talk about thyroid disorders. So to understand thyroid disorders, we need to see, for example, what type of diseases we can have. We can have diseases associated with hyperthyroidism, hypothyroidism, right? So for that purpose, let's see how does our thyroid gland regulate it. So let's start from the regulation of the thyroid gland. So there is one gland in our body, that is pituitary gland, right? Pituitary gland is divided into anterior pituitary and posterior pituitary. Now what is that? TSH. TSH is nothing but thyroid stimulating hormone. So thyroid stimulating hormone is produced by whom? Our anterior pituitary. Anterior pituitary produces our thyroid stimulating hormone. This thyroid stimulating hormone will go and act on the thyroid gland. Will go and act where? On the thyroid gland. So when it acts on the thyroid gland, it will produce our thyroid hormones, that includes our T3 and T4, right? So thyroid gland has a receptor. Let's go a little depth into it. Now I told that we have our TSH, right? Now where is our thyroid gland located? In the anterior part of our neck, right? It's a butterfly shaped gland. Now this gland, now for example, if you take this, our thyroid gland is made out of follicles. What are those? Follicles, they are called as thyroid follicles. Now when I take out a thyroid follicle, right? Now this is the epithelium of the thyroid follicle. On thyroid follicle, I told TSH is being produced. There is a receptor for the TSH. Now TSH will come act on the thyroid follicle where it has a receptor, that is TSH receptor. It will stimulate the thyroid gland and it will make thyroid gland to produce T3 and T4. Now whatever T3, T4 is produced, they won't keep quiet. We know already that is our negative feedback mechanism. T3, T4, whatever is produced will give anterior pituitary signal that stop producing TSH. Because I already, in my body I was already produced T3 and T4. So I have enough T3 and T4. Now T3 and T4, whatever is produced, that will go back and tell the anterior pituitary that stop producing TSH. That is our thyroid stimulating hormone. So this is a basic physiology, how does our thyroid gland work, right? So after we understood this much, let's start with disorders of the thyroid gland. What type of disorders we can have in thyroid gland? Generally, whenever we are talking about any gland, we will end up having two types of disorder, either hypo or hyper, right? So for that purpose, let me tell the basic classification of the thyroid disorder. We can have hypothyroidism, yes or no? We can have hyperthyroidism, means elevated level of thyroid hormone. Now we know hypo and hyper. Here I wanted to tell about one more thing, that is our primary and secondary. Primary and secondary. Now primary hypothyroidism, see, pay very important attention in thyroid disorder. Whenever I am talking primary means the defect is located in the gland itself. Now whenever I am telling primary hypothyroidism, where is the problem? Problem is in the thyroid gland, which is causing to the decreased production of the thyroid hormones. The same way, primary hyperthyroidism means I have an increased level of thyroid hormones, that is due to problem in the thyroid gland itself. Why I am specifying this term thyroid gland itself? The only reason is we have secondary hypo and hyper. Secondary means what? It is secondary to some disease associated with, for example, pituitary. Now if I say secondary hypothyroidism means what happening? My pituitary gland is not working. That is leading to what? Decreased production of TSH. When TSH is decreased, what will happen? Our thyroid hormone also decreases, right? So let's see what happens to T3, T4, TSH in each of the following scenarios, okay? Now I told primary hypothyroidism. Primary hypothyroidism, what happens? Now, do I have enough TSH? Yes, because my pituitary is absolutely working fine. So my TSH is normal, but it's not normal. Why it is not normal? The only reason is thyroid gland is not working. When thyroid gland is not working, what will happen? My body will sense that I don't have enough thyroid hormones. That will lead to elevated level of the TSH because my pituitary will try to compensate by producing more levels of TSH. Now primary hypothyroidism, TSH level will be elevated even though TSH is there. T3, T4 are decreased. Why T3, T4 are decreased? Because I have enough stimulation from TSH, but thyroid gland itself is not working. So this is the primary hypothyroidism. Let's talk about primary hyperthyroidism. Primary hyperthyroidism is nothing but I have a defect in the gland, which is leading to elevated level of T3 and T4. My gland independently producing T3 and T4 irrespective of TSH. When I have more T3, T4, what will happen? Let's go back to our negative feedback. Negative feedback is what? Our produced hormones will go back to the anterior pituitary and tell stop producing TSH. Now what will happen? More T3, T4, that will lead to decreased level of TSH. Clear? Now very simple thing. Secondary. Secondary means problem is where? In the pituitary. In the pituitary problem, there is no TSH. No TSH, that will lead to decreased T3, T4. Here problem is located in the pituitary. Gland is absolutely fine if I have enough TSH levels, that would lead to production. But here the problem is situated in the pituitary gland itself. Now when we are talking about secondary hyperthyroidism, it's more simple. Where is the problem? In the pituitary. That will lead to elevated level of TSH. If I have more TSH, more production to the, more stimulation to the T3. And T4 production, right? So this is a classification, this is a table. Why we need to know this table? We need to understand the importance of this table, because if I know how to interpret this table, we will be able to diagnose the patients whether they are having primary, secondary, hypothyroidism very easily. So this is a basic table which we should be able to interpret for understanding the differentiating factor between the primary and secondary. Right, so we are done with the classification. Now let's see how our thyroid symptoms will be produced. Right, now again let's compare hypo and hyperthyroidism and see what will happen. Okay, so I told we can have hypothyroidism, right? We can have hyperthyroidism. Okay, now hypo and hyperthyroidism, if we need to understand the symptoms, we need to know what is the basic function of the thyroid gland in our body. Basic function of the thyroid gland in our body is to maintain the body metabolism. Now if I have more thyroid hormone, more metabolism. If I have less thyroid hormone, decreased metabolism. Yes or no? And the next thing is, thyroid hormone is also important factor in the thermoregulation of the body. So it helps in maintaining the body temperature. Okay. Now let me give you an example to understand this. Take a person who is inhabited in the cold climate. So for example, if he is inhabited in the cold climate for a long period of time, comparatively his thyroid hormone would be little elevated, which may be physiological. Which may be physiological because he was living in a cold climate. His body was supposed to maintain the thermoregulation. For that purpose, body compensated by producing more of T3, T4. So this should be able to give a picture. Now let's start. What is the symptom of hypothyroidism? Decreased metabolism, that is decreased basal metabolic rate. Now if decreased basal metabolic rate in hypothyroidism, hyperthyroidism will have increased basal metabolic rate. Now very simple thing, what this will lead to? If I have more metabolic rate, so whatever stores present in my body is gonna be breaking, right? So I have, for example, lipids stored in my body, lipids will start to break. I have carbohydrates stored in our body, that will start to break because the basal metabolic rate has been elevated. If I am losing every store present in my body, that will lead to what? Weight loss or weight gain? See, whatever I am having in store, I am breaking that. So I don't have any stores. So that will lead to what? That will lead to weight loss. Now the exactly opposite, hypothyroidism, whatever stores is there, that is not at all being broken, that is adding up little more further, and that will lead to weight gain. That will lead to weight gain. So hyperthyroidism will have weight loss and hypothyroidism will have weight gain. So this is one symptom. Now very simple thing, whenever metabolism is elevated, what will happen? The very simple thing, whatever stores are present are being broken. When they are being broken, that will lead to what? Elevated body temperature. Because when basal metabolic rate increases, body temperature increases. So the patient who is having hyperthyroidism might complain to you saying that I have fever. But is it fever actually? No, it is just a elevated body temperature. Due to what? Due to our hypermetabolism caused by hyperthyroidism. So that will lead to what? Patient will have increased body temperature. When patient will have increased body temperature, what will happen? The patient already has more body temperature. Now he will have intolerance to heat because he won't be able to tolerate the heat because his body temperature is already elevated. So we call this condition as heat intolerance. heat intolerance. Exactly opposite thing happens. What will happen? Body temperature will be decreased body temperature or maybe maintained normally, and heat intolerance will turn into a cold intolerance. So this is the condition associated with the temperature. Now once we are done with the temperature, let's see about the cardiac rate. Heart rate will be elevated in the hyperthyroidism as well as respiratory. At the same time, when we are talking about hypothyroidism, heart rate will be decreased. So that will be leading to bradycardia, and respiratory rate will also be decreased. So now we are done with our cardiovascular system as well as our respiratory system and basal metabolic rate. Let's see further what can happen. Let's talk about GIT, gastrointestinal tract. Now whenever I have more metabolism, my intestinal motility and activity will be elevated. If I have more activity of intestine, that will lead to diarrhea. So the patient would have diarrhea. And what happens here? It's very simple. Opposite to diarrhea, the patient will end up constipated. So these are the basic few symptoms when we are talking about hypo and hyperthyroidism. Now we spoke about respiration, all this stuff, but there are few more things which will add up. Is in female, what will happen? This might lead to hyper and hypothyroidism, might lead to menstrual problems. In females, that might lead to menstrual problems. And one, let's talk about psychological aspect. What happens when they have hypermetabolism rate, high thyroid hormones? They might land up having psychosis. When we are talking about hypothyroidism, the patient might land up having lethargy. So these are the symptoms associated with our hyper and hypothyroidism. Now, apart from these things, the patient might have problems associated with the hair fall, and there is one more problem. It is specific to one particular type of hyperthyroidism, that is exophthalmia. Exophthalmia is nothing but our eyeball, whatever is present in the orbit, it will start to pop out a little bit, means our eyeball looks big. Okay, that condition is associated with exophthalmia. That is a condition associated with one particular type of hyperthyroidism. I'll be talking about in few minutes. So we're done with the symptoms. Now let's speak about the etiology. Now when we're talking about the etiology of hyper and hypothyroidism, what can cause hypothyroidism? Very simple thing, we have a disease called Hashimoto's disease. What is Hashimoto's disease? It's a type of autoimmune disorder. One of the most common cause for hypothyroidism is Hashimoto. Hashimoto's will lead to what? There is an autoimmune destruction of the thyroid gland, leading to the decreased production of our T3 and T4. It's very simple. I have thyroid gland, for example, these are my follicles. Now continuously, because of my immune system damaging this follicle, at one day I will run out of having follicles, and what will happen? There is no thyroid follicle, even though I have lots of TSH, no point having lots of TSH because thyroid follicle itself is not working. I will not have enough production of the thyroid hormones. Apart from that, it can be a complication associated with the thyroidectomy. Now what will happen? For example, let's take a patient who had subtotal or total thyroidectomy. After total or subtotal thyroidectomy, because of some disease, maybe malignancy, that will lead to what? I don't have thyroid gland, because thyroid gland underwent total thyroidectomy or subtotal. Now when I don't have thyroid gland, I will develop having hypothyroidism. It can be a complication associated with iodine-131 therapy. It may be associated with iodine-131 therapy. And one more important cause is drugs. Drugs can also cause the hypothyroidism. What type of drugs? One of the drugs which include are lithium. Lithium is a drug which is used in the treatment of mania. And we can also have problems associated with using of amiodarone. What is amiodarone? Amiodarone is a type of iodine containing class 3 antiarrhythmic drug. It is what? Amiodarone is a iodine containing class 3 antiarrhythmic drug. It might lead to hypo or hyperthyroidism. We don't know, it might end up having hypo or hyper. So the amiodarone is a drug which comes under the etiology for both hyper and hypothyroidism. Clear? So this is about our etiology for hypothyroidism. Let's finish the hypothyroidism story here. We'll come back to the treatment part. Let's talk about the etiology for hyperthyroidism. So when we are speaking about hyperthyroidism etiology, one important disease, that is Graves disease. Graves disease. Now, when I'm talking about Graves disease, I want to go a little depth into the Graves disease. For example, I was talking about thyroid follicle earlier. So this is my thyroid follicle. Thyroid follicle function is what? Thyroid follicle function is to produce lots of thyroid hormones as according to the stimulation which is produced by TSH. Now, I have what? I have a TSH receptor. TSH receptor will be stimulated by which hormone? That will be TSH hormone. Yes or no? This is our TSH receptor. TSH hormone, that is produced by whom? That is produced by our anterior pituitary. Now, anterior pituitary produces TSH. TSH will act on the TSH receptor, that will lead to the production of T3, T4. But in Graves disease, Graves is also a type of autoimmune disease. Graves is also a type of autoimmune disease. What happens in Graves disease? Very simple thing. There are autoantibodies. There are autoantibodies. But interestingly, very interestingly, they are stimulatory antibodies. They are what? Stimulatory antibodies. To whom? To the TSH receptor. Now just simple logic. Stimulatory antibody to TSH receptor means it works like TSH. Now what will happen? These antibodies will go continuously stimulate the TSH receptor, leading to the elevated level of T3 and T4. Now whenever I have Graves disease patient, what happens to them? I already told there is one condition more specific for Graves disease, that is exophthalmia. Apart from exophthalmia, now what happens? Thyroid follicles. Thyroid follicles are present all over the thyroid gland. If they are present all over the thyroid gland, I have enough stimulatory antibodies. Now my thyroid gland will start to produce more T3, T4. That will end up swelling. Why end up swelling? If I have more stimulation, follicles might start to enlarge. Why follicle will enlarge? Very simple thing. I have more stimulation, more colloid. More colloid is? Colloid is what? Colloid is a content within the thyroid follicle. That is the one which is converted into T3, T4. Clear? Now, very simple thing is Graves disease. Let's summarize. There is stimulatory antibodies to the TSH receptor. If you remember this sentence, all Graves disease will be understood very easily. Clear? So, this is about our Graves disease. So, clear. Apart from Graves disease, what else can cause? That will be our iatrogenic. Iatrogenic means what? Very simple thing. When doctor prescribed a large dose of thyroid drug. Or it might be, has seen in some people who is working as a nurse or maybe medical staff, what they might do is, for losing weight, with the incomplete knowledge, they might start taking the drug on their own. Even though they are normal, they might start taking the drug that might lead to hyperthyroidism. Clear? So why they might start taking the drug? Very simple. In the intention to lose the weight. Clear? So this is about our Graves iatrogenic. Okay, now in Graves, most important thing, pay attention in the stimulatory antibody. Now we can also end up questions or maybe any condition you might have to face, that is hypersensitive. What type of hypersensitivity Graves does the disease belong to? That belongs to type 2 hypersensitive reaction. This is a type 2 hypersensitive reaction. So all of these ending up having what? Large level of T3 and T4. Now this, we spoke about hyperthyroidism. Clear? Now let's see how to treat which group of people we need to treat. We need to treat both the people who is having hypo and hyperthyroidism, right? Let's see. Treatment. When I'm talking about the treatment, we have some drugs for hyperthyroidism. For hyperthyroidism, that is our treatment. For hyperthyroidism, we call them as antithyroid drugs. Antithyroid drugs. Okay. For hypothyroidism, what will you do? This is the most easy treatment. What you will do is very simple thing, that is called a replacement therapy. what you're replacing, your body doesn't produce enough level of T3 and T4. Just replace it with levothyroxine, L-thyroxine. Levothyroxine is a replacement therapy for hypothyroidism. When I'm talking about hyperthyroidism, now we have anti-thyroid drugs. What are those anti-thyroid drugs? That include carbamazole, and metamizole, and we have one more drug, that is propylthiouracil. Okay, so these are the three anti-thyroid drugs which we can use in the treatment of hyperthyroidism. But pay attention, you are treating a pregnant woman. If you are treating a pregnant woman, carbamazole is also not allowed to use, metamizole is also not allowed to use. Pregnant woman who is having hyperthyroidism, the only drug allowed to use is propylthiouracil. Okay, so apart from this, we need to treat one more condition, major condition associated with hyperthyroidism, that is elevated heart level and tachyarrhythmias. What is that? Elevated heart level, I told, elevated metabolism might lead to a tachyarrhythmia, tachycardia, and end up having a tachyarrhythmia. And one simple fact is that hyperthyroidism patient can end up developing atrial fibrillation. So for both tachyarrhythmia and atrial fibrillation, we need to use beta blocker. Beta blocker. Now beta blocker of choice for hyperthyroidism, that is propranolol. That is what? Propranolol. So beta blocker should be added along with propylthiouracil or maybe carbamazole, metamizole. For example, if she is pregnant lady, go for propylthiouracil. And hypothyroidism. Hypothyroidism is a replacement therapy with what? With our levothyroxine. Levothyroxine is a very simple thing that you are replacing the thyroid hormones, right? So this is about our hyper and hypothyroidism. Now we are done with hyper hypothyroidism. One last thing is, I wanted to tell very simple definition of the myxedema coma and finish it up. What is it called? Myxedema coma. Myxedema coma is nothing but sudden severe decrease of T3 and T4. Means sudden acute deficiency of T3 and T4 will lead to what? Will lead to myxedema coma. So it is an emergency condition which you need to replace the thyroid hormones and treat the patient. Okay, and one last thing I forgot in the symptoms is hyperthyroidism people can have one thing called pre-tibial edema. Hyperthyroidism people can have pre-tibial edema. Why pre-tibial edema as well as our exophthalmia? These both conditions occur in hyperthyroidism patients. Please do not forget that is due to hyperthyroidism. Okay, very simple, pre-tibial edema and exophthalmia in hyperthyroidism patient, because what happens, there is an elevated metabolism and that might lead to production of something called a glycosaminoglycans. That might lead to what? Glycosaminoglycans. What are these glycosaminoglycans? These are the water soluble compounds. Than water soluble, we can tell hydrophilic compounds. Hydrophilic compounds means what? Hydrophilic compounds are what? They are pull the water near them. Now what happens, these glycosaminoglycans end up getting accumulated in the pretibial region and behind the eye. That will lead to accumulation of the fluid and pretibial edema in the tibia, exophthalmia, because fluid is being accumulated behind the eye. So this is the story of our hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism and their treatment. Keep following, guys. Thank you very much.